So, good morning, everyone. Welcome to wonderful Bremen, which is currently a little cloudy, and which fits actually very well to this presentation, which is also going about Cloud RAN. I hope that at the end of the presentation, the weather gets a little better, that we can get outside. Now get serious. First of all, welcome in Bremen, welcome to iJoin. In line with what Albert said, I highly appreciate your attendance. I know it's not that easy to get to Bremen. You will learn a lot, so it's definitely worth coming here. And it's actually the kind of final event of iJoin, so we want to use this event not only, you know, to teach our colleagues who already saw many of these presentations a couple of times before, but to particularly teach externals, so that you learn a little bit about what iJoin did, that you can take a lesson from this project and bring it to your standardization committees, to your companies, to your university, so that we do have a long-lasting impact. Oh, yeah, call it a feature. All right. Okay, this is the outline of my presentation. So I start with a little motivation, then I go towards these two key concepts that have already been introduced by Albert. So that is RAN as a service and joint RAN backhaul design and operation. Then I'll give you a very long list of challenges that are actually tackled by iJoin. And I will not talk about all of these challenges, but I leave this to my colleagues who give you in the next 2 days many, many results to all of these challenges in the context of Cloud RAN. And then I'll give you quite a few results, more from an architectural point of view, from a system concept point of view, and not so much results, you know, on block error rates and then the tiny little details. Okay, so let's start with motivation introduction. And many of you have been to be witnessed many, many 5G presentations. And you know what's coming next, right? So we are at the step towards a next generation of mobile communication, and that's driven by tremendous data rate increase. And this data rate increase is expected. And sometimes, at least I'm asking myself whether this is some kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? So you have users, they expect more data rates, so we have to provide them. And once you provided these data rates, so just take your Samsung mobile and you suddenly have 100 megabits on your Samsung. Show this to your wife, to your friends. They will say, yeah, that's normal, guy. Come on, it's a mobile. It should have 100 megabit per second. But we know that this is, it's amazing, right? Having a mobile of 100 megabit per second throughput. And that's how mobile business works, right? We engineers, we provide the most sophisticated technology. And your mother will just say, oh, well, that's cool. That's how it should be, right? And this will go on and on, right? It has been so for the last couple of decades. So since GSM, it has always been this exponential increase in data rates. So over UMTS, CPRS, WiMAX, well, some of you may know WiMAX, LTE, LTE Advanced, and then there will be some LTE Evolution, 5G, whatever it's called. But something is quite often forgotten about this development, and that's communication is always directly coupled to storage capabilities and processing capabilities. So if you take a mobile and you want to process, I don't know, like half a gigabit per second, then somewhere this data must be stored and somewhere this data must be processed. And this will probably not be your mobile terminal, but it must be some other place with much more computational and storage power. And this gap between actually the per user capabilities and the per terminal capabilities, this gap is actually filled by something that's called cloud computing. And cloud computing came up, I don't know, like 5 to 10 years ago. Some of the older generation will tell you, well, this has always been there, IBM mainframes for a few decades, so nothing new. But actually there is something new about cloud, and that's the virtualization of resources and the seamless provisioning of resources. So you say, I want to have a few more CPU power, I want to have more storage power. And it is virtually, it is provided instantaneously without waiting for it. And you pay actually on demand, you can access it through any device that you own. You can, for the operator of such a cloud, you can pool resources, and you can actually measure what you're using. And this is something that we know now very well from the user domain, and it's now actually pushing over towards the mobile network domain. And the first area where this has been introduced has been the core network, so virtual EPC, and a lot in the NFV domain, so network functions virtualization, many of you know, hopefully. And there is very active community in this area. But so far, it has not been getting so much attention, at least product-wise, within the mobile network area, as well as in the backhaul network area. And that's where actually we as iJoint get in. So we want to introduce a system concept that is able to leverage from all these cloud computing concepts and all of these advantages that cloud computing can give you. And we want to make it better than systems that are existing already. So like many of you already know CRAN, so centralized RAN, which is based on the CPRI protocol. We know that there is RAN sharing. It's actively discussed within 3GPP SA1. We know that there is SDN, but we know not really how to apply it to a mobile network. And we know software-defined radio has been there for 20 years, 30 years, very, very long time. But it never really worked out, so it has never been really implemented. And that's something where iJoint gets in. Now, roll back a little. So we are again at the right side of this figure. That is, there are these users, right? So we still have to serve them, and then they have this tremendous data rate demands. And in iJoint, we investigate two key enablers which bring these data rates to the user, okay? And the first one is network densification. And network densification means we just take a whole lot of base stations, we deploy them throughout the city, and every base station can, at least theoretically, use the whole spectrum. That means, in the best case, our data rate increases linearly with the number of base stations. If you play a few tricks, it could actually be super linear, but let's say linear. And that's a very nice relationship, because if you would invest in large base stations, so we all know about Massive MIMO, for instance, there's still the question, how much money do I have to invest in order to get a linear data rate increase? Because it's not that easy. So we have that's the small cell concept. I think I forgot to mention it. So as we densify the network, as we have many, many more base stations, also cells become much smaller, and that's why they're actually called small cells. Now, in 2G, also mostly in 3G, cells were planned in a very sophisticated way. So you had a whole lot of engineers, and before you were rolling out networks, there were some guys at computers, and they were making up their mind, where do I put the base station so that it doesn't interfere with too many other base stations, that I have a very high coverage, very high capacity. And now imagine you try to do this with 1,000 small cells in Bremen. I don't think this will work, right? So you need some central intelligence during runtime, which is able to coordinate small cells, which is able to say, okay, this small cell should now lower its transmit power. It should only use part of the spectrum. It may cooperate with another small cell, or we just turn it off because there's no user using this small cell. So you need some degree of centralization, which allows us to coordinate, to orchestrate these many small cells. And as mentioned, there's currently a standard, a technology called centralized RAN, CRAN, based on the CPRI protocol. And CRAN does it already. So, but the story doesn't end here, fortunately, because CPRI requires optical fiber, or at least a very expensive, very high data rate microwave link, which costs a whole lot of money. And if I now try to connect all my small cells with, for instance, optical fiber, I either have to trench a whole lot of cables, which costs a lot of money, Or I need to provide a transport network that is able to get the data rate from the small cell to the central processor. And this transport network is not a legacy transport network, but it will be dedicated to the CPRI protocol. And this is, again, a lot of additional investment that I have to bring to the network. And that's something that we want to avoid. So in iJoin, we have two key concepts. And the first concept is that we say we want to centralize our network very flexibly. That means we have down here our small cells, our radio access point, and then we have a heterogeneous backhaul. And this heterogeneous backhaul may be composed of optical fiber, because it's still there, microwave links, maybe even some out-of-band relings using WiMAX, why not? And then we have a central cloud platform. And it should be really a cloud platform, not some kind of a C-RAN++, but it should leverage from the cloud computing paradigms. And now, depending on what kind of central, what kind of backhaul you can actually offer for the radio access points, you then centralize a little more functionality or a little less functionality. So far, so good. There's still a backhaul in between the radio access points and the cloud platform. And if you have now a few thousand small cells that need to be centralized, then it may become a little, let's say, difficult in order to say which small cell should centralize the upper MAC, the file layer, or whatever part. It becomes very difficult to orchestrate which routes should be taken or which, how much capacity is provided for which part of the network. And in order to automate this, to operate such a network in an optimal way, we actually consider in the second part of the project a joint RAN backhaul design and operation. That means we have one large SDN controller, which is permanently monitoring the cloud platform, the backhaul network, and the radio access network, and then actively controls the particularly backhaul network. And later on today, actually, Carlos Bernardos will tell us much, much more about this topic. And before I go towards more results that you can have a better view on gains for this idea, I would like to dig a little deeper into this RAN as a service concept. And for that purpose, I have drawn this figure. And on the left-hand side of the figure, you see a way how a conventional base station is implemented. So usually you have starting from the RF, so the analog part, and upwards towards the admission congestion control, so including file processing, MAC layer, RM, everything in a distributed way, so implemented at the base station. And then starting with the network management, so NMS, EMS, you have a more centralized intelligence. And some of you may know SON, so self-organized or self-optimized networks. That's kind of the first centralized decree in current LTE networks. Now, the opposite of it is on the right-hand side, and that's C-RAN. That means we have the analog part. Of course, it's still distributed, so which means your antenna, amplifiers, power control, so adaptive power control, and then everything which is digital, so file layer, MAC layer, RM, and so forth, is centralized at so-called baseband hotels or baseband pools. And that means nothing else than I take really this rack, so it's a huge rack which does all the digital processing, I take it, I put it at a central place, and that's it, period. There's a little more, of course, I don't want to insult anyone active in this area. So a lot of trouble with routing, synchronization. So it's really difficult to implement such a system. But that's the basic idea. You really take the base station and you centralize it. Now, as mentioned, if you have a wireless backhaul, this doesn't work, right? So you cannot run CPRI over a high latency or low throughput backhaul network. And that's why we need some intermediate steps. So for instance, we only have a partly centralized RM, which does some inter-cell interference coordination, or you have a partly centralized file layer, for instance, that you centralize the decoding. And each of these intermediate steps, as we see later, has its pros and cons. And in the next, today and tomorrow, we will give you more details on the challenges of each of these splits, as well as the benefits. The benefits in general of RAN as a service are manifold, right? So I think I could fill a whole hour only with benefits. Of course, I'm the technical manager of the project. So But the probably most apparent one is computational diversity. And that means, assume you have 1,000 small cells, then the likelihood that all of these small cells are fully loaded at the very same time with the highest data rate is almost nil. So in reality, this will never happen. In reality, it's the other way around. At a certain point in time, probably only 10 to 20% of your small cells are currently really highly occupied. The rest of the small cells, they're in almost idle mode. Now, there's no reason to have resources provided for those small cells that are not loaded, right? And that's this centralization, this pooling gain that you can exploit in a really, on a cloud-native radio access network implementation. That means you have this baseband pool to the left, up left here, and then you hold resources for, I don't know, like 30, maybe 40. Gosh, there's actually now the first problem that we see. How many resources do we actually implement in this centralized RAN? And that's one of the major goals in IHR, and that we provided an analytical framework as well as a demonstrator that shows you how many CPUs, so really Intel CPUs, I have to provide if I centralize 1,000 small cells on a cloud computing platform. And it's something in the order of 1/3 of the number that you would require if you provide full resources to every small cell. So almost 2/3. Gain in number of provided resources. Now, the second major benefit that I personally see is so-called localized optimization. And that means in 5G, we will have a high diversity of scenarios. So we have soccer stadiums like Werder Bremen playing Hansa Rostock in 5 years. We have metro stations, we have rush hour, we have downtown, we have machine type communication, vehicular communication. Every one of you who ever read a report of Metis knows there are many, many, many scenarios. And for each scenario, we have an optimal algorithm. And it's almost infeasible that one base station could provide all of these algorithms at the same time. This is such a huge complexity for the implementation of a base station that you would rather go for one algorithm. And this algorithm is implemented, it's robust, it works, period. You don't really optimize on an algorithm basis at base stations. Once you centralize it, once you really put it in software and you make it a replaceable software, you could actually use whatever software you want. You could even, and that's something I think operators would like to see, you could even allow for third-party software. So there are specific problems with specific solutions by third-party providers, and then you just use the software. Okay, now let's go a little deeper into the joint RAN backhaul concept. And current architecture in LTE architecture has actually two sides. The first side is the logical architecture. That means you have some logical entities like the UE, the ENodeB, and some core network entities like the MME, and they communicate with each other on a logical level, right? And then you have a physical architecture. That means you have some real physical connectivity between boxes, and at some of these boxes you have these logical entities implemented. Now, this becomes even more complicated once we have network functions virtualization. That means if core network functionality could be distributed more within the network. And then it gets even more complicated if radio access network functionality would be more distributed within your physical network, right? And then the logical architecture and the physical architecture, they will be somewhat decoupled. So they can be very, very asynchronous, so to say. And this requires a joint operation and a joint optimization. That means once I knew which logical entities are communicating with each other, then they have some certain quality of service constraints like latency, throughput requirements, packet loss rate. So there's a whole lot of these requirements. And then I as a network provider, have to make sure that these constraints are fulfilled. And that's in IHR and done through an SDN controller, so a software-defined network working controller that you see here on the left-hand side, which is then able to, for instance, monitor the RAN as a service, so the cloud platform up here, And then flexibly adopt the degree of centralization based on, for instance, availability of processing resources, or based on the particular software that is required for the service that is running within the network. We can differently prioritize user and control traffic. We can actually actively control the topology. We can perform load balancing within the network. And yeah, one very important point is actually also the joint activation and deactivation of backhaul and radio access nodes. Because if I suddenly turn off a radio access node, then this has inherently also an effect on the backhaul network. And I think Antonio is going to talk a little more about this topic, I think tomorrow, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. So now, this was the first flash, the first iJoin flash that you got. Now I go a little more into details, challenges, and results. And this first slide gives you a list of, let's say, system-wide challenges that were addressed in iJoin. And the first one is, which function splits are feasible? That means, if you have a wireless backhaul connectivity, then you will not centralize the whole file layer, but a little less, I would assume, right? So we actually investigated which function splits are possible and what are the benefits of these splits. Then you have actually very tight real-time constraints in LTE. And the probably the most difficult one is the hybrid ARQ constraint. That means after receiving a code word, you have exactly 3 milliseconds time to send the acknowledgement for this packet. And within the 3 milliseconds, you have to process the packet and you have to prepare the answer. This includes all the fire and MAC processing. And 3 milliseconds is not much if you imagine a backhaul connection with 1 millisecond latency. Then I think it becomes apparent that this is almost infeasible if you want to keep this constraint. Actually, in iJoin, we derive one technology called opportunistic hybrid ARQ, which is able to break this hybrid ARQ constraint and to implement a centralized RAN even with high latency backhaul. Next topic is data center placement. That is, where do I put my data centers? I don't want to centralize them too much because then my transport networks may become overloaded and I create a single point of failure. But I also do not want to distribute them too much because then I am not able to exploit this computation diversity anymore. The next point is dynamic network control. There, particularly protocols are interesting, as well as timescales. So how often am I able to update and monitor my network? Multi-cell processing under imperfect backhaul. So we all know comp and multi-user detection as a technology for perfect backhaul. So we have very low latency backhaul connectivity. This becomes much more difficult under imperfect backhaul and in particular in DAOP2. So what Dirk is going to talk about, we have a whole lot of technologies which are able to tackle this imperfect backhaul. We have resource management of the virtualized environment. That means within the cloud computing platform, we need some resource management. That means which CPU is processing which base station, how many CPUs are turned on or are provided for the network. And this is a very, very difficult task. And it must be a task which is done jointly with the radio access network. Right? So you need radio access network information in order to perform a working resource management within the cloud platform. And I think that's something that Andreas is going to tell us a little more today. And then finally, we did a very detailed cloud RAN cost efficiency study, particularly focusing on the CAPEX side, because C-RAN is still, well, a little too costly, I would say. And we did a cost efficiency study showing that with the iJoin system concept, we are actually in the almost the same order as current distributed radio access networks, so cost-wise. Okay, now I show you a couple of results in the remaining time. I think not much time left. And I will focus here really on system concept results. And one of the most important things that a EU project has to provide is architecture, right? Something that PhD students usually don't like that much, but it's very important because in many EU projects, you only derive new technologies. little individual technologies, but which do not really fit together. And in iTime, we actually have a dedicated work package, as well as a lot of resources dedicated to harmonizing this output and to bringing up one consistent system concept. And in the first part of this harmonization, we actually defined common scenarios. So we used a dense hotspot scenario, stadium, a square, wide area coverage, and indoor hotspot. Then we derived a new, or we derived a logical architecture which is legacy compliant, so no changes to LTE, but which is still able to implement the iTrain system concept. We used this and we provided a set of physical architectures. That means if I have a logical architecture, if I have my common scenario, how is it really deployed? So where do I put boxes? Which connectivity is required? Then we derived a so-called functional architecture. That means I take all of these functions that now interact with each other. So physical layer, MAC layer, and the cloud platform. Then we have the SDN controller. And they all somehow have to interact with each other on a physical architecture. So there are some interfaces between these functions, and they run over some physical connections. And this is then actually harmonized in our system concept, which actually also includes a proof of concept, so real implementation of these concepts. And this is a lot of architecture, right? And I will not try to explain all the little details, but I would like to refer you to, I think, a set of very important reports of this project. And the first one is the deliverable D5.3, which brings, which lists the architecture side, so logical architecture and physical architecture. And then the individual deliverables 2.3 and 4.3, we actually list the functional architecture side, so much more details on how the individual technologies are interacting. And then finally, in deliverable 6.2, we provide a proof of concept description. So we implemented iJoin, and in this deliverable, we describe how this fits also to the other deliverables. And they are actually ready by end of April, so probably on our website in May. So if you're interested, so if you're still interested in iJoin after this meeting, then you're very welcome to read these reports. I think I skipped this part. So this is actually the functional architecture that I mentioned before. So we have three main technical work packages. One which is on physical layer, led by Dirk. Then one on more MAC RM layer, which is led by Andreas. And then one more on the network and management, MAC network management and network control, which is led by Carlos. And for these three work packages, we defined then interfaces. So what is the real information that you have to exchange between technologies? And just to give you one example, we have this SDN controller that is going to control the radio access network, backhaul network, and cloud platform. And in this functional architecture, we define then what is the actual information that the SDN controller has to obtain from the network nodes, and what are the measures taken by the SDN controller. Okay, and that's, as mentioned, described in will then be described in these deliverables. Then a very important architecture that we derived mainly in WP3 is the cloud architecture. And this is very, very important in the sense when we move radio access networks toward cloud computing platforms, then this must not be a one-to-one porting. So you cannot just take a current LTE implementation and put it on a cloud computing platform. It will never work for many, many different reasons. Among others, real-time constraints will not be met, and this system will immediately break. So you need something that takes care of the characteristics of the cloud platform, and you need a manager which is able to steer the cloud computing platform. And sounds easy, but it was a very long discussion. So which controllers are essential, which controllers are really necessary, and this is going to be described in very detail in work packet 3, so in deep 3.3. And let's say the main result is that we have up here the RAN as a service concept, and we have these direct interfaces where the RAN as a service manager controls the virtual eNode Bs. And then this is, and from my point of view, a very interesting interface because it contains on the one hand side radio access information, for instance, link adaptation parameters, but on the other hand, also processing related information. So how many resources are available for a virtual eNode beam? And this is this joint concept where communication and communication comes together within one controller, which I think is one of the main results in iJoin. Now, the feasible splits, I would like to go through them very quickly because you will see, I guess you will see this slide a few more times today and tomorrow. And if you think about possible splits of the radio access network, then probably you could come up with, I don't know, 20, 30 different splits. And probably almost all of them make sense, but not all of them are necessary. And in iJoin, we agreed on four major splits. And the first one is split A here, which is kind of the legacy split, so the CPRI-based split, where you just centralize all digital processing. Now, the second one is where we split between a lower PHY and upper PHY part. And some of you may are aware of work that has also been done by Alcatel-Lucent, which it goes into the direction that you actually want to split between base station specific and user specific processing. And that's exactly this split. So you keep all the base station specific processing at the base station itself, and all the user specific processing is then centralized. And in iJoin, we just agreed that the first function that is centralized with this split is the forward error correction. Okay. Then we go the next higher split, which has much looser latency constraints than split B. And that's the split between PHY and MAC. Actually, I think hybrid AQ should be down here in PHY for this split. And some of you are possibly aware of the small cell forum virtualization initiative, and they really call it MAC-PHY split. And it's very much related to the so-called femto-RP, so FAP split. And it's probably a very reasonable one because most of the computational burden is kept at the base station, and a lot of benefits can still be obtained through central interference coordination. And the last split is right beneath the PDCP. And the reason for that is to only have security, so ciphering only once within the network, so that you don't have to perform it at the base station and the Cloud RAN at the same time. Now, of course, the gains get higher the lower we get in the protocol stack. But as there is no free lunch, except for this workshop, also efforts and costs are actually also increasing if we go down in the protocol stack with our centralization. And this is one of the main tasks in iJoin. So what are the cost benefits, for instance, and what is really feasible? What are then the error throughput benefits? And in order to answer actually the cost efficiency benefit, we did a analysis of computation requirements for a Cloud RAN environment. And actually can keep this slide very short because I'm going to talk about this during the afternoon on computational complexity in Cloud RAN. But the main result here, is, you see on the left-hand side, is the normalized complexity per base station. And what you see is it's a very steeply declining curve, right? And that means if I centralize already in this example like 20 base stations, so fully loaded base stations, then I have a computational gain of roughly factor 2.5. That means if I would take one base station and its computation requirements, and then I multiply it with 20, then I would need roughly 2.5, 3 times more the resources compared to a Cloud RAN system. Okay? And this is also shown here on the right-hand side. These dashed lines are the required number of servers, so equivalent servers in a non-virtualized environment, while the solid lines show the number of servers in a virtualized environment. And yeah, apparently the slope of the curve is much higher in the case of a non-virtualized environment. Now, at the end of the project, not only for the final audit, but that's one of the motivations, is the final audit, we have to show results. And one way is, of course, to show 50 slides with with different, you know, different technologies. And the other option is to have only like 3 or 4 very specific numbers. And in iTrain, we decided before the project that we want at the end of the project exactly these specific 4 numbers which characterize the benefits of iTrain. And these are actually the area throughput. We targeted 100x improvement without a spectrum increase. So with a normalized spectrum, we said we want to increase the area throughput by a factor of 100. Energy efficiency should be 5% of the baseline, which is actually LTE release 8, I think. Then the utilization efficiency should go up to 75%, and the cost efficiency should be below 10% compared to current systems. And I would say we did a very good job. So we are currently in the very final phase of this evaluation, what we call project-wide analysis, where we take all the technologies, we put together the improvements, and we make one, let's say, system improvement out of it. And for the area throughput, naturally, most of the improvement comes from the physical layer as well as the MAC layer. And we actually have a set of novel uplink technologies like multi-point tour detection in network processing, what actually Armin mentioned already this morning, where we have gains roughly in the order of 100%. We have novel downlink technologies like hierarchical pre-coding, small cell clustering. We have some, what I think, very amazing MAC technologies, where we have, for instance, a robust link adaptation, cooperative scheduling, also a joint RAN backhaul scheduling, where we also have gains in the order of 100% and more. And we have a couple of new backhaul technologies where the radio access network and the backhaul encoding is done jointly, and where we can actually benefit from both domains. Plus, of course, the assumption is that we have a 10x densification, and then we actually come up, I think we get in the order of 100x. If it's 60x, honestly, I don't care, but it's a significant improvement and we are going to achieve. For the energy efficiency part, it's a little more difficult because ask someone what is the energy efficiency metric that you're using, and you ask 20 people and you get 20 different answers, right? So it's a very, very difficult metric compared to area throughput, which I think is very clearly defined. And in iTrain, we actually did a, Dario Sabella, Telecom Italia, drove a work on energy efficiency measures that is much more sophisticated, which includes the radio access network, the backhaul network, as well as the cloud computing platform. And we came up with a couple of new technologies on PHY, MAC layer, also network control. And there the problem is that you get easily into oscillations, right? So you have one algorithm which does some SDN control of your network and working on a larger time scale. And then you have other algorithms like DTX, which is working on a very small time scale. And there you have to make sure that you don't get oscillations, so that both effects don't counteract each other. But it looks good, so I think we get into this 5% that I mentioned before. We did, as I mentioned, a detailed cost efficiency study where we compared our iJoin system, so including costs for radio access network, backhaul network, for data centers. And we compared this with a distributed RAN that you see here with the green curve. And we compared different data center densities. And in the best case, you see roughly 7% improvement. These 7%, they will change. So if you change parameters, it will be, maybe it's getting 5% more expensive. Maybe it's 15% more cost efficient. The very important lesson that we got from this part of iJoin is we are in the same order as a distributed RAN system. So we are not like an order of magnitude more expensive compared to traditional LTE implementations. And then I think what I like a lot is the utilization efficiency study, where we investigate how much percentage is our radio access network, our backhaul network, and the cloud computing platform used. Actually, Antonio did a very nice job in doing the first part, so the radio access network and backhaul network. utilization. And here you see the other part, that's the cloud computing platform. And you actually see here curves for different outage constraints. That means usually systems are designed, so data centers, when they run radio access net or mobile network functionality, they're designed for 5.9, 6.9 reliability, so very high reliability. And the question is whether we really need this, because if we run at only 90% reliability in the radio access network, then probably the cloud computing platform doesn't need to have 99.99999% reliability, but much lower reliability is possible. And that's what you actually see here. So the blue curve is the utilization of our cloud computing platform for reliability with 10^-4 failure rate. And the green curve is for a failure rate of 10%. And what you can actually, what we can see is that with higher reliability, also the utilization of the system goes down. And that's a natural consequence from the fact that there are sometimes these peaks in resource requirements, both in radio access network as well as then on the processing side. And in order to serve these very few peaks, you have to significantly over-provision your system. And that's why utilization of your system goes down the higher the reliability is. And what down here, you actually see the non-virtualized implementation. So we are somewhere between 20 and 40-50% utilization. And up here is actually then the Cloud RAN environment. And in most cases, in particular, if you have a lot of small cells centralized, we're actually at almost full utilization. So at kind of more than 100% utilization. And that's kind of cool, right? So you buy, I don't know, 1,000 server racks to serve your Cloud RAN. And most of the time, you actually use 90% of them. So really, what you pay is what you're using. And it's very interesting. Finally, we actually have a lot of demonstrators and testbeds implemented in iJoin, which is very important, I think, for an EU project to show that we're not only living in a theoretical domain, but really we want to show that it works. And we have three major testbeds. The first one is the RAN as a service testbed, where we implement, for instance, a turbo decoder and the Cloud RAN management entity within a cloud computing platform. We have a joint RAN backhaul demonstrator where it is shown that you can use a joint encoding over the radio access network and a 60 gigahertz backhaul link. And we have an SDN testbed with, I don't know, like a few dozen nodes that are controlled by an SDN controller, which is monitoring backhaul load and radio access load. Now, the first two parts are actually shown. I think the first part is shown live here. The second part, we have a video, right?
That's also
live here. Cool. The third part is actually not here because it's shown next week at Mobile World Congress. And we just wanted to avoid this, that all these nodes are, you know, transported twice through Europe. So we decided to not show them here, but we have a poster showing what is actually done on the SDN testbed. All right, so conclusions, and not only the conclusion that we go to coffee break in 1 minute, and I can see you desperately looking forward to it. So in iJoin, we're actually investigating a couple of very new paradigms. So a virtualized, a cloud-native radio access network using commodity hardware, using virtualization and a pooling gain. We investigated resilience to communication and computation imperfections, like imperfect backhaul, that you have a high latency backhaul, which has then implications on the hybrid ARQ constraints and on real-time constraints in the cloud computing platform. And all these relations were actually investigated in iJoin. And we have a couple of very new results, I would say. So I think we have one of the first very detailed cost efficiency studies on Cloud RAN. So I mean, there are a lot of white papers out there by Huawei, for instance, China Mobile, so particularly Chinese vendors and operators, which are very interested in this topic. But you never find detailed details on the assumptions and on the scenarios that were investigated. We showed that actually also cost efficiency and then performance in the end really depends on micro effects, on let it be the latency on the backhaul, let it be the hybrid ARQ constraint, or even the link adaptation. How it is done can have a major effect also on the cost efficiency in your network. And there are many, many more results, and I think we have, I don't know, like 2,000 journal publications. They're available through our website. And end of April, we have, as I mentioned, a set of deliverables, and they will definitely be finished by end of April. And yeah, if you're interested, please drop either Albert or myself an email, and we will also give you then the pointer to these reports or send them directly to you. Now, last but not least, I think Albert mentioned that a large project with 12 members, so many, many results. And I think what I like most about iJoin is that we not only are a set of partners investigating a set of technologies, but it's really a project investigating common topics. So in the area of this functional split investigations, joint RAW and backhaul. And we have, I think, a very strong industrial background with Telecom Italia, NEC, Telefonica, Sagem, Intel, HP, so both from the communication, so telecom part and the IT part. We have two research institutes with IMDEA from Madrid and CEA, Antonio's here. And we have four universities, so University of Bremen, obviously, Armin De Corsi, University of Zurich, that's Rahim Tafazzoli. Some of you may know him, I think. University of Dresden, that's Gerhard Fettweis. And yeah, University of Madrid, that's actually Carlos. Okay, that finished my talk. I hope you have a lot of questions that we can discuss today and tomorrow. And I think the floor is again yours, right? Sure, please go ahead.
Okay, you mentioned in the area of collaborative scheduling, yes, you have 100%+ gain. My question is now, from my understanding, what is your baseline there? Without against no coordination at all, or coordination within the conventional distributed schema?
That's a very good question. The baseline, if I'm not mistaken, is with. I think the baseline, so in this particular example on coordinated scheduling, is if you would perform a coordinated scheduling over imperfect backhaul, but ignoring that the backhaul is imperfect. Because what then happens is that channel state changes, that maybe decisions that you do centrally are outdated once they're delivered to the base station. As I mentioned, it's very tightly coupled, actually work done by Richard, tightly coupled with link adaptation, which is even more of a problem, because once you make a link adaptation centrally, you give the result to the base station, channel's outdated, and you get errors. And there I think it's like roughly.
Yeah, but you didn't answer my question.
the comparison is so the baseline is LTE and with coordinated scheduling. But if you ignore an imperfect backhaul, so that's the baseline. And then the improvement of roughly a factor two, is it in the end, so 100%, is if you take into account that you do have an imperfect backhaul, so that means you need some interface from the SDN controller that measures the backhaul and then tells the cloud platform, hey guy, this algorithm now has to take into account 2 millisecond, 4 millisecond backhaul latency. And then this algorithm actually improves by roughly 100%. So that's the comparison done there. I guess it would be even more if you have no coordinated scheduling as a baseline, then it would be even more.
And I would more guess that, that your baseline is no coordination.
Maybe Richard can answer it. I think it's with coordinated.
I think the factor of 2. So
okay.
But you can do also their coordination via central scheduler, but you take into account your latencies here via the activity.
Well, today you cannot, right? So today I think you don't have any interface between the kind of some backhaul controller and then your, for instance, if it's.
So you can do. Today there is there are already deployments existing where we centralized coordinator, which coordinates in terms of conventional distributed RAM elements.
If you're not talking about Sond, or because I mean
in the technologies of Sond or whatever you want to call it, but there are already deployments existing.
Yeah, sure. I mean, you have in Sond, if you then have your like your proprietary EMS system, it could be that you can do some tricks, but I think the only actual measurement of backhaul latency and then backhaul throughput can be done over the S1 link. So there's no really radio access measurement that you can deliver to the base station so that you can say, okay, I have this latency, I have to take into account. Probably there may be some proprietary solutions in the context of EMS, but I think even the NMS interface doesn't have this property. I mean, we can...
At least in the time domain, you can do a coordination already with existing switching protocols.
Okay. Good.
Because the coherency dimension is critical in the time domain. But when you want to go to the spatial or to the frequency domain, of course, you have short coherency
times. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
There you are. You can do more when you have a lower... When you have this lower...
of course.
Control flow.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. If there are no more questions, then I would say we go to coffee break, right?
Yes.